Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. God, the Father in heaven, have mercy on us. God, the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God, the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity in one God, have mercy on us. So we understand your holy will, grant our prayer, O Lord. May we realize our true relationship with you in this life and the life to come. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we continue to work with you in building your kingdom on earth. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we unite ourselves with you in the sacred mystery of the altar. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we recognize the greatness of this most holy sacrifice through which we worship you. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we feed on the bread of life, no more to hunger. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we have a share in the offering of Jesus on the cross. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we fill our lives with your ideals, join with you in the supper of the Lord. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we perceive always and everywhere your all-pervading presence. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we end our days with your holy name in our hearts and on our lips. Grant our prayer, O Lord. Forgive our sins, O God. Grant our prayer, O Lord. Cleanse and renew our hearts. Grant our prayer, O Lord. Lord, bless us with the wisdom to praise you in spirit and in truth. So by following your holy will, may gain eternal salvation. Amen. Well, I welcome you here this morning, and it's a kind of different Sunday from last Sunday when we had all of our snow. It's supposed to get near to 50 degrees today, so up and down. But anyway, we're here for the Lord's celebration of the Mass. We're halfway through the school transition season of pre-Lent. We're only about 10 days away from Ash Wednesday. So as we gear up for that, at this time, I ask you to please make a private examination of your conscience. And then we now recite the Confiteor together. I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, who knows the inmost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow for the many sins by which I have offended you. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify, endeavoring henceforth to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I ask all those who dwell within the Church of Christ, the Blessed Mother Mary, the holy apostles, martyrs, and faithful, who have lived, suffered, and died for the gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as you, my brothers and sisters, to witness my confession and pray for me to our Lord God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and Merciful Lord give us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Show us your mercy, Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, that in purity of heart we may worthy fulfill this holy action, established in remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said that where two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy we may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments and by love, truth, and justice. And may we say together, let us pray to the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, invisible, revealed in triune power for all times, now, and forever. The Lord be with you. Father, your Son serves as our perfect example of love. Help us to sincerely pray for those who dislike us and to those who would make themselves even our enemies. We ask through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Let's prescribe by the church for this morning's Holy Mass is taken from the Old Testament book of Leviticus. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel, and say to them, 'You shall be holy, for I, the Lord, your God, am holy. You shall not hate in your heart anyone of your kin. You shall reprove your neighbor, or you will incur guilt yourself. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against any of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord.'" This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Beloved, do not look for revenge, but leave room for the wrath, for it is written, "Vengeance is mine, and I will repay," says the Lord. However, if you fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God, as you cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthy proclaim your holy gospel. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthy proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you. Reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. And Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said, 'An eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth.' But I say to you, offer no resistance to one who is evil. When someone strikes you on your right cheek, turn the other to him as well. If anyone wants to go to law with you over your tunic, hand him your cloak as well. Should anyone press you into service for 1 mile, go with him for 2 instead. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn your back on the one who needs to borrow. You have heard that it was said, 'You shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy.' But I say to you, love even your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your heavenly Father, for he makes the sun rise on the bad and the good, and he causes rain to fall on the just and the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what recompense will you have? Do not tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brother only, what is unusual about that? Do not pagans do the exact same thing? So instead, be perfect just as your heavenly Father is perfect." This is the gospel of the Lord. Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Last Sunday, if you were able to brave the snowstorm, you heard in the sermon about the first four of Jesus's "But I say to you" statements. Today we hear numbers 5 and 6. Last Sunday I mentioned the only way that these kind of statements have any merit is because of our relationship with Jesus. We have to accept him as having the personal authority to change long-lasting tradition, to change law, and even to change ourselves by changing our expectations. If we don't have that kind of personal relationship with Jesus, then Jesus's "But I say to you," that has no basis, because the "I" is unimportant. All 6 of these pronouncements are audacious, and none more so than today's. They surprise and they challenge us now, even 2,000 years. You would think they would be used to Jesus' gospel, but now, 2,000 years later, when Jesus says, "Turn the other cheek," if somebody wants to take your tunic, give them the cloak too, and you know, this idea of not only loving your ones who love you back, but loving your enemies, those are surprising and audacious now. We have never, ever gotten used to that message. And this is why I said last Sunday that Jesus can never be confined to any particular formula. He can't even be confined by an institution such as church. He can't be confined even by a holy book that we call our Bible. He's always going to surprise us. And as believers, we have to always be thinking about Jesus' core proclamation and his fundamental example. And then we need to figure out, through that strange combination of our brain and our conscience, what Jesus would have us believe and what Jesus would have us do today. We can't just find simple answers. We can't escape the responsibility of being thoughtful believers. This responsibility simply cannot be passed off to anyone else, no matter whether it be the Holy Church, the Holy Bible, or those short little catchphrases that you see often from religious people. That is not going to be the same as a relationship of faith. Faith has to be relationship. And you know, as well as I do, that relationships are always changing constantly, and it is our unavoidable religious responsibility to try and keep up, because Jesus is perfect, and unless we're perfect, we always have somewhere to go to meet Jesus, so we're always changing in our relationship. So I'd like to take this morning's lesson as an example. Bill read for us Leviticus 19, which is the beginning of something that scholars call the Holiness Code. And in these passages, God lays out how he and the people of Israel can somehow live together, because in the Old Testament, the idea that God was so holy was that he was scared, and that if you offended God's holiness, God had no other action, but or no other choice, but to strike you down. And it was terrifying to come into the presence of God. So the Holiness Code was a way for God and Israel to commune together. So the people must strive to be more like God. They need to be godly, in other words. And God reveals quite famously, "You shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy." And Jesus takes that thought, he says it just a little bit differently. He says, "Be perfect, just as your heavenly Father is perfect." But remember, his repeated holiness code comes after 6 of "I say to you" statements, where he takes the old commandment and reinterprets it according to his own authority. This is what I mean by keeping up with our faith relationship and never letting it settle, because Jesus is still going to say to you, "But I say." So morality, for example, is not cutting out a little catchphrase from the Bible and then using that little catchphrase, isolated from everything else around it, to kind of protect what we already believe. And in that holiness code, we do that all the time. We take these little segments of that holiness code, and if we believe them, then we kind of plaster them all over the place, and we say, "This is what holiness is," but right next to it could be something else that we disagree with, and we completely ignore it. Morality is still about listening, even when we don't want to believe. And that's where the challenge of faith begins. That's where growth starts. Morality is not about God becoming more like us, but us becoming more like God. And for us here, God is displayed perfectly in Jesus. And for us here, Jesus is displayed perfectly on his road to the cross, which we are just beginning to. The cross is Jesus' revelation of a scandalous love. Our reading from Leviticus and its holiness code demands, says the law from 3,000 years ago, we have to love those who love us. Jesus comes along and says, "But I say to you, that is not enough. He says, turn the other cheek. He says, love your enemies. And we're supposed to love like this in this strange way because that's the way God loves us. None of us here deserves God's love, but each one of us here is loved by God because he loves as initiative. The Almighty makes the sun rise on the good and the evil, it's said today in the gospel. He sends his rain upon the righteous and the unrighteous, says today's gospel. God's love is universal, is proactive. God leads with love, and it is part of his very nature. He doesn't wait for us to love him. He loves us first. And if we are to be holy as God is holy, if we are to be perfect like God is perfect, then we have to try to understand this unbelievable mystery of Jesus dying on the cross. We have to try to bring this kind of love into our definition of our own everyday lived morality. And that means that it's hard. It means that it's not the natural kind of love where you love the ones who love you back. It means going to the cross, somebody sticks a spear in your side, and you still say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So again, this Sunday, I've included a little picture at the back of your song sheet, and I just ask that you take a quick little look if you could. There's a new documentary film out called Accidental Courtesy. It's about Daryl Davis, and he's the man to the left in your picture. Now, he's a blues musician, but in his spare time, he has taken on a special project. Daryl Davis goes out of his way to socialize with and befriend members of the Ku Klux Klan and other neo-Nazis. And I wasn't sure how good that picture was going to come out. There are people who may be watching at home on FCAT. But Daryl Davis is a black man. And for many of the people that Daryl meets, he is the first, he is the only black person that they have ever spoken to in their lives. And a lot of these people are down in the southern regions where there's a lot of black people around them, but they build walls and they will not associate with them. In some cases, this new relationship that Daryl builds is so impressed with white supremacists that they have dropped out of their hate organization. Daryl Davis even has a collection of discarded robes and hoods that have been given to him by these people who have been changed simply by getting to know the person that they assumed that they were supposed to hate. Now, this is a film I think that we could show here at Holy Name at some point to talk about this context of, you know, turn the other cheek and love your enemy. And if you'd like to watch it on your own, I've included the PBS link, the electronic copy of today's sermon that this afternoon will be posted on our website. And people can assume hatred. We can assume that we are not supposed to like these other people before we know them. But relationship can destroy those assumptions. I think one of the greatest threats to our Christian morality is isolation. And this is what worries me about our heightened fear of immigrants. And Sharon was telling me this morning, she was getting dressed and watching the news, and it just strikes me as strange that people are fleeing out of America and into Canada because they're terrified of the American government. I don't know what your political views are, I'm not going to tell you mine, but that just strikes me as strange that people are fleeing out of our country. It used to be the other way around. And also there's that increasing divide among Americans where there are red and blue states, and sometimes we have red and blue people and we don't even talk to each other anymore. That scares the bejesus out of me. You know, I've only seen part of the Jackie Robinson movie. Now, Mr. Robinson, as you probably know, is the first professional black baseball player. And one scene, one that I saw, a boy and his father at the ballpark, I think it was Cincinnati, and the boy's father and the others around him, when Jackie Robinson comes out into the field, and please forgive me, but this was said in the movie, they start yelling, nigger, at him. And the boy seems confused by this anger. He's all excited about watching baseball. He sees only a baseball player. And he's watching all these other guys around him yelling that word, and he imitates it. He learns to hate because he sees other people hating. Then one of Mr. Robinson's white teammates from that same city, he comes over to first base, the place where Jackie was playing. He puts his arm around Jackie Robinson's shoulders, and he stands there. And the two of them together look up into the stands at all of these people who are booing and jeering the both of them. And the boy at that moment learned another lesson besides hate. And again, it was based on relationship. People assumed that they were supposed to hate Jackie Robinson because of the color of his skin. Relationship just destroyed that whole idea. This is the normal kind of reaction to those challenging, "What I say to you, Jesus statements about loving when it is the hardest thing to do or even imagine." It simply means building relationships. So may our Christian morality be challenged by Jesus' words, and especially at this time of year by his cross. May we learn to love as an initiative and not only as a response to those who already love us, and to love when it seems so darn strange to try and love somebody who just doesn't like us. And may we pray that our faith relationship with Jesus inspire us to build relationships with so many others that somehow we figure out how to live together. And for this may we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty Lord, as we gather before your altar on this Sunday, the second of pre-Lent, which we're only about 10 days away from Ash Wednesday and Great Lent, we offer you our prayers for Frank Kozakowski, who passed away recently, and this prayer is being offered by his wife, Angela Kozakowski. We also offer prayers for the health of Joe Potraala, who had a heart attack this past week, and this is being offered by Teresa Belisle and Kathy Blodgett. We also offer prayers for my uncle, Frank Osowski, who died this past week at the age of 95, and he was the last of my uncles, and I have no more uncles and aunts. The entire Osowski family of that generation has passed away to their eternal reward. So we remember Frank Osowski this morning. We also remember Irene Calvo, whose birthday was on February 6th, Rudy Calvo, whose birthday was 1 week later on February 13th, and then my father-in-law, Henry Vishneski's birthday, which would be tomorrow. All of them have passed on to the eternal reward as well. We remember them on their anniversaries of birth. We also pray at this time, or continue to pray, for Liz Bridgman, who is battling cancer and raising three young girls on her own. Alex, a 16-year-old with lymphoma, Hodgkin's disease. And Alicia, a young mother of three with stage 4 breast cancer, is offered by Cindy Benjamin. We offer our prayers for Frank Skrosky, is offered by Brother Don, Skrosky, Gates, and Kirkendall family. We also offer prayers for Bishop Thomas Benat's health, and also for the strength and well-being of his wife, Catherine, is offered by myself. We also offer prayers for those battling cancer, Meg Connors, by Ellen and Don Skrosky, Fathers Ray Dreda, and Maurice Lizelle, is offered by myself. Richard Poe is offered by the Poe and Foster families, and 2-year-old Jack Soleil is offered by Mariana Foster. Are there any other prayers you'd like to offer? For all of these prayers, Lord, plus the private ones that we bring before you at this time, and we ask you, Lord, to bless each and every one of us here gathered, to be with those of our parish who are unable to be with us here today, those of our parish who are traveling during the school vacation week, and also those who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace. May the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us, for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary, and became our Savior was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory, judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. He has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. He sins who despises the hungry, but blessed is the one who helps the poor.
Give us the season of anticipation.
that takes us from the joy of your incarnation to the penitential mood of fasting and the contemplation of your passion. As we prepare to abstain from worldly trappings, open our hearts and our minds to a spirit of true contrition and of loving reverence for you. Therefore, the angels and archangels, with all the saints in the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We therefore, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to accept and to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy, unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, employing you to defend and guide throughout the world, together with your priests and all true believers in the holy faith. Remember, Lord, your servant. All present in this congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule, and fatherly love, wholeheartedly this day, united in spirit with all of those, together with the most blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise as apostles with all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life and his most precious blood, just as they believed, professed, and united with you, through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world, and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment, when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the real heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, with the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all those who loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me, and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will, and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word. My Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one. As you, Father, are in me and I in you, I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me I would have in my company, where I am to see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me shall ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst. After these and other words of the Archpriest in prayer and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his Almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given for you." Taking this excellent chalice into his holy, venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which will be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, mindful Lord, we as your servants and your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, we receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive for the joyful countenance from him, who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls the saving remedy. We humbly ask you, Almighty God, command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angels to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life, and to those that are in life straight from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their suffering. We ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts are always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence. Forever and ever.
Amen.
be with you always. May the union of divinity and humanity in Jesus Christ bring us sanctification and eternal life. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom. You live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be caused by judgment. Though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving master awakened in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it at last unite me entirely with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns with God the Father, in unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to speak, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces that he has given me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy to speak, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Body.
body and the blood of Christ. The blessing of God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Almighty and merciful God bless you. the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. Beginning of the Holy Gospel according to St. John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was in God's presence, and the Word was God. He was present to God in the beginning. Through him all things came into being, and apart from him nothing came to be. Whatever came to be in him found life, life for the light of men. The light shines on in darkness, the darkness that did not overcome it. There was a man named John sent by God, who came as a witness to testify to the light, so that through him all might believe, but only to testify to the light, for he himself was not the light. The real light which gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and through him the world was made, yet the world did not know who he was. To his own he came, yet his own did not accept him. And he who did accept him, he empowered to become children of God. These are they who believe in his name, were begotten not by blood, nor by carnal desire, nor by man's willing it, but by God. And the Word became flesh, and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of an only Son coming from the Father, filled with enduring love.